Okay. Hi, good morning. Today we'll try and go through cardiac catheterization hardware and also the contrast that we use during cardiac catheterization. I mean, this is a topic which essentially, I think it needs a more interactive kind of forum. So we'll try and do it as an equals, and then in between, I think if you have any doubts, you just need to, you know, ask me and through your chat box. So just open that. That's fine. Okay. So first thing that we need to be aware of is the properties of a catheter. So what are the important properties of a cardiac catheter that you know, that you have to think about when you decide on which one to use? So there's a list of them. Just try and shoot off as many as you can think of. Oops. Guys, are you there, people? Properties of a cardiac catheter that, you know, that you should be aware of, that are, you know, critical for you to decide on which catheter to use for what purpose. You need to interact, otherwise it becomes a really quite boring, this talk. Anybody? No answers at all? Excellent. Oh, there is life at the other end. Good. Okay, so fine, I've got lots of answers. I think all of you can see them. Okay, so right, so we have pushability, talkability, you know, the specifics of the catheter, like the size, you know, the length, etc. Good. So we'll try and go through each of them. So what is trackability? Trackability is essentially the ability of a catheter to track over a wire. Okay, some catheters track very easily. For example, if you use a Terumo Glide Cath, which is a soft catheter, usually it is black in color in the lab, and it goes over a Terumo Glide wire. And these both these surfaces are hydrophilic. So it's one of those catheters that you can use to get into very difficult positions. So difficult PA entry or something like that. sometimes you may enter the PA, say with a standard right coronary catheter, which is stiffer, but you may enter with a wire, using the right coronary catheter to position the wire, but you may not be able to track the right coronary catheter over that wire. So when you try and track the right coronary catheter over the wire might slip out. So then what you can do is you can use an exchange length wire, remove the stiffer catheter, and then over the exchange length to remove, you can use something, you know, like the Terumo Glide Cath, which tracks very easily over the wire and gets you into difficult positions. So trackability is one. We talked about pushability. What is pushability? Pushability is the ability of a catheter to transmit forward pressure. So when you push it forward, it should be able to move forward. And to some extent, the stiffer the catheter, the more it is going to respond to that push. So a soft catheter like a Glide catheter may not push so well. So say you, if you don't have a wire and you just have a soft catheter, then you know, when you try and move forward, it might either kink or, you know, or get stuck and may not push forward. So the stiffer the catheter, you're able to push it better. Then you have something called torqueability. Torqueability is the ability of a catheter to transmit rotational force. So if you have a straight catheter without a curve, okay, there is no curve at all, then rotation doesn't affect the catheter in any way. But majority of catheters will have some curve. Even if it is a mild curve, for example, a multipurpose, you know, does not have a very acute curve, but it has a curve. So what that curve does is that it directs the tip in a particular direction, so that when you rotate that catheter, the tip will move according to your rotation. So the ability of a catheter to transmit rotational force is called torqueability. Okay, and once again, slightly stiffer catheters can be torqued better than softer catheters. Okay, so stiff catheters may not track very well, but they usually are better to transmit forward force and for torqueability. Softer catheters, like we discussed, we have the Terumo Glide cap, which is the black cap, you know, that is very soft, which can be used over a wire usually. And then the Berman is another catheter which is very soft. It's not a very stiff catheter. So it's a balloon-tipped catheter. I'm sure you've seen it in your labs. And it is quite soft. So if you try and use the Berman without the balloon, you'll notice that it's very difficult to get it to move forward. It has a tendency to, you know, curl up in a chamber. So these are some of the basic characteristics of the catheter. In addition, of course, you have the size of the catheter, which is usually measured in what units do we use to measure a catheter. The size of the catheter, that is the diameter of the catheter. French, that's right. And approximately one French equals how many millimeters? Correct. So, you know, of course, there's a huge range of catheters that are available from as small as three French up to, you know, much higher French values, depending on the type of catheter and its utility. So if it's just a standard angiographic catheter, usually, you know, it doesn't exceed 7 or 8 French. And if it is a sheath, for example, a delivery sheath, then it can go quite high up to about 13 French or so. And of course, for a really, you know, like say the implantable valves, they have their own custom-made sheets, which are much, much bigger. So if you look at some of the other qualities of a catheter, one of the important qualities is memory. Okay, so it's the ability of the catheter to return to its original shape. So particularly important for us if we are using EPO material, because the catheter is preformed in a certain shape. For example, the pigtail has an end which is curled. You know, different catheters have just different curves. So their ability to, when even in a brand new catheter, during the course of the procedure, what happens is because of the body temperature being you know, higher, the catheter material becomes soft and it can lose its original shape. So memory is basically the ability of the catheter to try and retain its shape, you know, during the procedure. Shape of the catheter is important. It decides, you know, which one you're going to use to get to a certain point. For example, see, the multipurpose has a shallow curve, like we discussed. It's an ideal catheter to cross the atrial septum. So normally you would either glide it up the IVC and just automatically drop across the atrial septum, or you would go into the SVC innominate and then slip down and drop it across the atrial septum. The RC, on the other hand, has a more acute curve, a shorter curve, and it's ideally suited to enter the right ventricle, to look up from the right ventricle into the pulmonary artery, to cross, you know, to position for wire entry into the pulmonary artery. So each catheter has a specific shape, and it's important to know the various catheters that are available, not only what we routinely use in our pediatric practice, but also what is available in the lab, because there are a huge variety of catheters that are available, which are generally used by either the adult cardiologist or the interventional radiologist, which can be of use to us as well. The profile of the catheter is important, which is the size of the catheter, like we discussed already earlier. Generally, you know, we have to aim to use the smallest catheter possible for a given indication. And we are all aware of the problems of arterial access in small children. I think people who have worked in units who, where there is a significant adult congenital population will understand the difficulties that repeated cardiac catheterization in these patients gives rise to in later life. So they often lose their femoral veins and arteries, and it becomes exceedingly difficult later to catheterize them or to perform interventions on them. So right from the outset, there should be an awareness that we should preserve these vessels to the best of our ability. So try and avoid arterial access as much as we can, and use the smallest French catheter that we can for the purpose that we need. Stiffness, I think we've already discussed at some length. Most catheters have a softer tip than the body. Okay, so there is an atraumatic tip, so that the tip doesn't damage the vessels or the cardiac structures. Often the tip is radio opaque. It has some radio opaque material impregnated so that it is more clearly visible on fluoroscopy. Okay. Now, occasionally we all know what we do, particularly when using sheets, is the sheet tip gets sprayed, and because of the fact that we sometimes have to reuse this material, cut the tip, and I think all of us are guilty of it. We have to be a little careful whilst doing it, that there are no sharp edges. It's not a recommended practice, but in certain resource limited circumstances, these things have to be done. So you have to be careful not to leave sharp edges, and also be aware that we may be the catheter which is more proximal is stiffer, in our manipulation we have to be much kinder and gentler. The holes of the catheter are important. We'll discuss a little later on in the talk. So whether a catheter has got side holes or end holes, depending on the indication or the utility of the catheter. Okay. So next we move on to the materials used to coat catheters. Can you name some of the materials that are used in making a cardiac catheter? Guys, what are the materials? Okay, polyurethane, good. So it's one of the most common materials that is used, polyurethane. What are all the materials you can think of that go into making a cardiac catheter? Anybody else? Cardiac catheter or sheet, let us say. Okay, so now multiple materials are nowadays used, often catheters are multi-layered rather than a single layer. The outer coating is usually polyurethane. Yes, other materials like Teflon, nylon can also be used. Teflon catheters are a little stiffer, they have to be used with more care, whereas the polyurethane catheters are softer. So that is why when you take and use different catheters from different companies, there is a different feel to them. Okay, so the same multipurpose, depending on whether it's from Cordish or some other company, will have a different kind of softness or feel to it. So you have to become kind of familiar with the different brands and how stiff the catheters are. Even though it may be the same shape, then there may be a variation in the stiffness depending on the material they have used or the proportion of the material they have used. So in addition to polyurethane and Teflon, several of the catheters have a middle layer, which is either stainless steel or Dacron, which acts as a scaffold in a way. It gives some strength to the catheter, it also gives a little bit more flexibility so that the catheter doesn't kink or bend, and it can actually be more flexible. So these catheters, this is termed as braiding. Okay, so a lot of catheters nowadays are braided catheters. So This is a diagram of the structure of a braided catheter. So you have an inner core, which is usually made of Teflon or some similar material. You have a middle layer of braiding, which is stainless steel or Dacron or some similar material. And then outside you have a polyurethane coating. The tip of the catheter, like we discussed, will have some radio-opaque material so that it is more clearly visible on fluoroscopy. Okay. So this is just to understand the structure of a catheter. So if you have an old catheter in the cath lab that anyway you're discarding, you can actually cut through it to understand, and you'll be able to see that the wire braiding that kind of unravels when you cut through it, help you understand the structure of the catheter better in real life. Okay, so can you identify the various curves in this catheter? So what are A, B, and C? Anybody? So this is a very useful, yeah. So A, B, and C are the primary, the secondary, and tertiary curves. So the important thing to remember is the primary curve is the most distal, kind of curve, or the one closest to the tip. Okay, so the one closest to the tip of the catheter is the primary curve, and then you just work your way around to, then you have the secondary curve and tertiary curve. Can you name this catheter? What is this catheter? They're quite a useful catheter to get into collaterals or perhaps certain difficult pulmonary artery positions, etc. Particularly useful for collaterals. It's not an Amplatz catheter, although I do agree that it has certain characteristics of an Amplatz catheter. I'll give you a clue. It's black in color, so. So this is it's called a sidewinder. It's a Terumoglide cap, okay? It has this complex kind of curved structure, and it's commonly used to get into small vessels, etc., or difficult, awkwardly positioned vessels. So this is just to understand the concept of primary, secondary, tertiary curves. So the primary curve is the curve that is closest to the tip of the catheter. So for example, this is these are the Judkins catheters. What is this catheter? These are the coronary catheters. What is this catheter? The one on the left of the screen. Which one is the Judkins left and which one is the Judkins right? Right, so the one that I'm pointing to is the Judkins left, and this is the Judkins right. So in the Judkins left, you have the primary curve, which is closer to the tip, near the secondary and tertiary curves. Okay, now in the Judkins right catheter, the primary curve, which is just a very short portion of the catheter, then you have the secondary curve, and then the tertiary curve. This is how you identify the curves of the catheter. Okay, what is this catheter? I'm sorry for the poor resolution of the picture, but I think we see enough detail to be able to identify it. What is this catheter? Identify this catheter. Correct, absolutely. This is the Berman angiographic catheter. Why do we say it's the Berman? Why can it not be any other balloon tip catheter? What are the features? What are the features of a Berman's catheter? It has no end hole, correct? And it has multiple side holes. So it's a balloon tip catheter, no end holes, multiple side holes, usually made of very soft material. It cannot be taken over a wire because it does not have an end hole, and it has to be maneuvered mainly based on the inflation of the balloon. Okay, and like we discussed earlier, it has a tendency without the balloon to keep curling up in chambers. but it's useful. What are the utilities? When would you use a Berman catheter? Okay. Yeah, so it's essentially its main role is for angiography because it has all these big nice side holes. So it is used to get RV angiograms or P angiograms. Once again, one of those catheters that can be used when you're not able to get into the pulmonary artery easily. In some units, the Berman is used a lot routinely. I don't use the Berman as frequently unless there is some specific indication for it. But you know, it is a nice atraumatic catheter to use. It does require a certain skill getting familiar with how to use it. But nowadays, I think with the advent of wires, it's reasonably easy with the Terumo wire to enter most places. So generally, overall, I think the use of the Berman worldwide has come down. Okay, so difficult to navigate, difficult catheter courses with a balloon tip for angiography, like we said. One of the specific indications of the Berman, not standard indication, is you can do in small babies balloon occlusion angiography. So I have used this catheter in, say, for example, a small baby with pulmonary atresia and MAPCUS. The venous side, catheter can be introduced through the venous side, and because of the VST and aortic override, you can take it into the aorta, across the arch, into the descending aorta, inflate the balloon, and then inject through the catheter. So because of the fact that the balloon is inflated, it prevents runoff of the contrast distally, so that you get much better opacification of the collaterals. So what happens normally is because the aorta in this instance is anyway dilated and has a lot of flow through it, it is difficult to opacify clearly the collaterals with just standard angiography. You can use a pigtail, but if you find that the pigtail angiogram is not very clear or that you would like better clarity, then this is a possible technique to use where you occlude the aorta distally using the balloon tip of the Berman and inject through the Berman so that there is no runoff and you can then see the proximal aorta and collaterals more clearly. Okay, so next we go on to the contrast medium. Essentially, when we talk about contrast, we have ionic contrast and non-ionic contrast. All the contrast material that we use in the cath lab is iodine-based. We don't use ionic contrast nowadays. They're all non-ionic. But they are classified depending on their osmolarity. So even each of the brands has a variety of offerings based on the osmolarity. So there are multiple kind of solutions that are available. So you have hyperosmolar, isoosmolar, and hypoosmolar contrast. And it is important to choose either isoosmolar or mildly hypoosmolar contrast. Generally, hyperosmolar contrast is avoided. In patients who have renal problems, there are certain renal protective contrasts that are preferred. One of them is Visipay. So this compound called iodiaxanol has been shown in studies to be the most renal friendly. So generally in the lab, when you have a patient with impaired renal function, it is perhaps preferable to use that, or when you're using a lot of contrast in a small baby, perhaps it's preferable to use a more kidney friendly contrast. Okay, so what are the side effects of using contrast agents? What are the possible complications or side effects? Obviously, we have talked about the kidney. Apart from that, what are the non-renal complications of contrast agents? Anaphylaxis, that's right. So hypersensitivity reactions or allergic reactions. What is the common kind of side effect that the patient describes to you? It need not necessarily be a serious complication, but it's an effect of the contrast. Okay, so the unusual sensation is a kind of a flushing sensation. Okay, so this is because of vasodilatation. So contrast can produce vasodilatation and a feeling, a flushed feeling. They can also have a sensation that they want to urinate, although most often it is not a real sensation. It's just that feeling that they have. So it can produce, because of the vasodilatation, it can produce hypotension. Along with hypersensitivity reactions, the more common kind of side effect or effect of contrast is flushing and vasodilation. Occasionally, it can have a negative inotropic effect on the heart and cause arrhythmias as well. These are relatively rare. You know, we use contrast all the time, and this is something that doesn't happen very often at all. Also, children seem to be pretty resistant to contrast, injection. Although I'm by no means suggesting we take it lightly. But adults are much more complicated in terms of the use of contrast because several of them have pre-existing renal problems. They may be diabetic with existing renal failure. So there the management of contrast administration becomes much more complex, and they may need pre-preparation with hydration and medications to kind of allow the use of contrast during procedures. So we've gone through this now. I think we've covered all of these. So what is the usual recommended dosage of contrast in children? So, I mean, this is a ballpark figure. Of course, there is a huge variation, but you have a guide, right? I will try not to exceed this quantity of contrast in my patient. So what is the usual kind of ballpark that we use in ml per kilogram? Yeah, so usually it's around 5 mils per kilogram, body weight. But in some long or complex interventions, it may be necessary to exceed this limit. However, I think right from the outset, when you're anticipating a difficult procedure, you have to take all the precautions possible right from the outset to minimize the amount of contrast. And this may mean using layered contrast. If biplane angiography is available, obviously that reduces the amount of contrast usage because it gives you two planes of angiograms with one shot. Planning your intervention, carefully right at the outset. For example, you already have a pre-existing, say, CT image of that child. Then going through that CT image prior to intervention, so that you know exactly where you need to go, and you don't need to do any general angiograms. You can just do selective angiograms. These are some of the strategies that you can use to minimize the usage of contrast in these patients. So we said planning, limiting the number of angiograms, small syringes. So when you're catheterizing neonates or infants, try not to have very big syringes on the operating table because, then you're tempted to use higher quantities of contrast and saline. So you don't want to fluid overload them, and you don't want to give them too much contrast. So in a small baby, usually I just tend to have 5 ml syringes on the cath lab table so that I don't use either too much fluid or too much contrast. And if we, midway through a procedure, you realize you've already used a lot of contrast and you need to use more, then make sure that you hydrate the child properly so that the contrast is, passed out in the urine. And even post-procedure, this hydration needs to be continued. Occasionally, a dose of diuretics can also be given, a small dose. Remember, the diuretics are also nephrotoxic, so don't overdo it. But yeah, you can give a small dose of diuretics to encourage, passage of urine. Okay, so how do you classify, catheters according to the holes? What are the different types of catheters or classification of catheters according to holes? And can you just give some examples of each? This is a very simple question, so I expect quick answers so that we can proceed with the rest of the talk. How would you classify catheters based on the holes? And give some examples. Guys, I don't think this. Yay, okay. So you have end hole catheter. We get an answer. Swan Ganz. Yes, Swan Ganz does have an end hole. It's also a balloon tipped catheter. NIH. NIH. NIH does is not a. Okay. Yeah, NIH is a side hole catheter. Side hole Berman. Yeah, the NIH was actually one of those original catheters which I used a lot when I was training. Don't see it very much nowadays, but it's a very nice angiographic catheter. It's completely achromatic tip, so it has a a rounded tip and side holes. The NIH is a side hole catheter. Multiple side holes, both end hole and side holes. You can have the pigtail is one of them. It has an end hole. It also has multiple side holes. Also, the multipurpose A2. Okay, it has an end hole and side holes. Multipurpose A1 has only an end hole. So that is not a particularly good angiographic catheter, MPA1. The MPA2, on the other hand, has a good number of side holes and end holes. So what is the reason for not wanting to use an end hole catheter for angiography? What is the fear? Why don't we want to use an end hole catheter for angiography? Anybody? Why don't we want to use an end hole catheter for? Correct. So because although we don't see it very commonly nowadays because we use adequate precautions, one of the things that can be done to safeguard ourselves is to give a small test dose. So prior, just to confirm that the position, the catheter is not wedged, you can give a small test dose before you give your full injection. That is the benefit of using catheters with with the side holes and not injecting, not doing angiograms through end hole catheters. Okay, so side hole only catheters, we said NIH and Berman, very good. End hole only catheters, end hole only catheters, we said MPA1. RC is the other one, right? The coronary catheters, coronary angiographic catheters are all end hole only. End hole and side hole we've talked about. Okay. And the one of the utility of catheters with only end holes, these are useful for pressure monitoring. Although one of the problems with these catheters is sometimes the because there is only one hole, some tissue can get lodged in this hole, actually damping the pressure trace. Traditionally, these are advocated for pressure measurements, particularly when taking gradient measurements. When you're trying to measure the pressure in a specific portion of the heart, for example, you're doing a withdrawal from the pulmonary artery to the RV, in a patient with valve RPS or something like that, then the fact that there is only one discrete hole at the tip helps you do that, in an accurate fashion. Because when you have side holes, you get a mixture of measurements. Say, for example, you're using a pigtail across the RVOT. The side holes will be in the RV and the end hole will be in the PA, so the pressure measurement will not be accurate. So end hole catheters are useful to get pullback gradients and to measure pressures accurately. Also, you can get blood samples. But like I said, when you take blood samples, sometimes you can have wedging of tissue, which prevents you from drawing back. Okay, and also it can be used to selectively cannulate vessels. For example, when you're looking at collaterals, that you're trying to occlude a collateral, using a catheter like an RC or a similar catheter, it helps to perform selective angiograms in small vessels. Okay, so can you identify this catheter that you see here? What is this catheter? Can you identify this catheter? Right, this is a Swan-Ganz catheter. Swan-Ganz catheter is a balloon tip catheter. It has an end hole, like you can see. So it's different from a Berman. So here you can see how it is different from a Berman. Berman had a lot of side holes, you remember, and it had no end hole. Here you can see it has an end hole, so it can be taken over a wire as well. What are the utilities or applications of the Swan-Ganz catheter? What do you use the Swan-Ganz catheter for? right heart hemodynamics. So it is used a lot in an ICU sort of setting where it can be used to measure the pulmonary artery pressure, the pulmonary capillary, exactly, to measure the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and cardiac output. So the Swan-Ganz is a very useful catheter for measuring right heart hemodynamics. And in the adult ICUs particularly, a lot of critically ill patients will have this catheter in order to monitor on a continual basis their cardiac output and hemodynamics. In our setting, we use it less frequently, but it can be useful, particularly to measure pulmonary artery pressures. Okay, so yeah, and it helps you. So when that catheter, when the Swan-Ganz is in the pulmonary artery, and you measure the pressure, that gives you the PA pressure. Now, when you inflate the balloon, what happens is only the distal pressures are recorded. Okay, so that will give you your pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So then you can calculate the transpulmonary gradient between the PA pressure and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Okay, so in that way, this is a pretty useful catheter. Of course, balloon tip catheters are also used, like somebody has mentioned here, during interventions. For example, you have a large PDA, which is a hypertensive PDA, and you want to assess the suitability for device closure. Then one of the strategies that is used is actually to balloon occlude the PDA and look at the PA pressure, the fall in PA pressure. And there are certain cutoffs which tell you whether it will be safe to close this PDA with a device. So for that, you can use either balloon tip catheters, or you can use balloons themselves. You know, the valvoplasty or angioplasty balloons, those can also be used to occlude the PDA, and then you can determine the fall in PA pressures. Okay, sorry. So identify this catheter shape. I think I've already given you the answer, but what, for those of you who have not seen the answer, what shape is this? Anybody? What is the shape of this catheter? Yeah, correct. So this is a cobra-shaped catheter, and once again, it can be useful for, it's got a very nice shape. So one of the, things you can use the cobra for is if you're doing, for example, a tetralogy cath, okay, or a pulmonary atresia, VLT cath, a lot of the time it may not be necessary to use arterial access, because there is a huge VST, there is overriding of aorta. So a catheter which has a shape similar to a cobra, once you enter the RV, it helps you cross the VST and get into the aorta just with a bit of rotation. So it's a very nice shape for entering the aorta from the RV through the VST. So that's one of its applications. Okay. So we talk about guide cats, okay, guide cats, not glide cats, but guide cats, predominantly used in coronary artery intervention. So what are the differences between angiographic catheters and guide catheters? What are the differences between the angiographic catheters and guide catheters? So if I have a 5 French RC and a 5 French RC guide, what is the difference? How are they different? Any answers? Okay, so the internal lumen of the guide cath is much larger. That's right. So that is the main benefit of a guide cath. That is, although the external lumen is the same, that is, it can go through a 5 French sheath, the internal lumen is much bigger. So what is the internal lumen of a guide cath? What is the normal internal lumen of a normal angiographic catheter? Anybody? You need to know this. Okay, unless you know what the internal lumen of a catheter is, you don't know which wire to use, right? So the angiographic catheter, usually the internal lumen is 035 to 038, usually around 038. Whereas the guide cat, it has a much bigger internal lumen. It can be, you know, 052 to 06. So each one is slightly variable. But this is of great benefit when you're trying to do interventions through the guide cat. Apart from a bigger internal lumen, what else, you know, what is the other benefit of a guide cat? What is the other property of a guide cat? How else is it different from an angiographic catheter in its properties? One is its larger internal diameter. The other is stiffness. Okay, so guide cats are exactly. So guide cats are much stiffer than normal angiographic catheters. So they give you more stability. In situations like PDA stenting, perhaps a guide cat is useful. It acts like a sheath for that stent. So it's a stiffer catheter. Okay. So now we move on to guide wires. You know, we use them a lot. There are a huge variety of wires that are available. Several properties that you need to be aware of. One is, of course, the length of the wire. It's very important. The guide wire has to be longer than the catheter, at least 20 centimeters longer than the catheter. You have various lengths. What is the length of a standard wire? What is the length of a standard wire? Okay, so if you, correct, 150 centimeters is correct. So 150 centimeters is the length of a standard wire. You have, what is the length of an exchange wire? Exchange length wire, what is the length of the exchange length wire? Yeah, usually it's 260 centimeters. So around 150 centimeters is your standard wire, 260 centimeters is your exchange length wire. The coronary wires have different lengths. They're often kind of slightly more than a standard wire. So it's about 180 to 190 centimeters. Apart from that, you know, you have, apart from the length of the wire, the other property of the wire that is important to you is the stiffness of the wire. Okay. So you can have a standard wire, which is, you know, only mildly stiff and pretty soft, safe to use even in, you know, in neonates or infants. Then you have wires that have a stiffer core, which have greater stiffness. The Amplatz family of wires are available. So you have ultra stiff, super stiff, etc., with varying degrees of stiffness. And these will usually have a floppy tip. So the length of the floppy tip is quite important relative to the length of the child or the size of the child. In any intervention, it's important that the floppy tip is safely, you know, distal to the area of intervention. So, for example, if you're trying to balloon an area, the valve or portion that you want to balloon or stent, that should have the stiff wire. So, the floppy wire should be distal to that. And similarly, when you're doing an ASD device, for example, the floppy portion of the wire should be, you know, safely in the lungs. And the stiff portion should be clearly across the atrial septum. If you have a small baby and a wire with a very long floppy tip, then that might be a problem. So you have to choose a wire that is appropriate for that child. So if you look at the structure of a guide wire, it has a core or a mandrel, and over that you have a coil, a layer of coil that extends throughout the length of the wire. So if you look at your standard wire and you examine it closely, you'll notice that it's actually not just smooth, but it's coiled. There's a coiled layer on the surface. And usually the wire is also coated. Now it can be Teflon coated. Some of them are coated with a hydrophilic material like the Terumo. And these wires have to be dipped in water to make them you know, easy to use. Okay, and the tip is atraumatic. So it has a bead which is soldered on at the end. and that makes it atraumatic, so that it doesn't pierce through structures. And that is why when we reuse wires, we have to be careful that they are still intact and in good condition. So we've kind of gone through that. Okay, so then we have the braided sheets. These are sheets which are highly flexible. They don't break or kink, but they allow flexibility. Okay, and examples of them, these are arrow sheets and flexor sheets. So these are the metallic sheets that you see here are arrow sheets, often used for procedures like pulmonary artery stenting. They have stainless steel braiding inside. These are the flexor sheets. So just a few examples of sheets that you can use for various interventions. Okay, guide wire thickness range with examples. Okay, so you have a variety of wires. The most common range of wires which extends between 014 and 038. Okay, so the coronary wires are usually 014 inch in diameter. Then you have 018 wires as well. For an example of that is the platinum plus wire, and there are similar wires to that. Most of the standard wires are 035, like the standard Teflon wire is 035. The Amplas wire is 035. There are slightly thicker wires which are 038 as well. And sometimes when wires are EPO'd and come back to us, we don't have the original packaging. The 035 and 038 wires may get a little confused. But these are the standard diameters of wires that we use. And you need to be aware of what wire you have in mind, what catheter you're using, and what the compatibilities are. See, this actually we've already touched upon about the French measurement and it being equivalent to 0.33 millimeters, so I won't go into it in any great detail. So, you have these charts which tell you, which give you the equivalent millimeter measurements for the Frenches, and these are readily available. I'm sure you can get it on the internet. Okay, so we come to this set of catheters, very commonly used, very popular. So what are these catheters that we're seeing here? Based on the shapes, very simple. Usually comes as a set, correct. So this is the Judkins right, the Judkins left, and the pigtail. And this is the standard set of catheters that is used by the adult cardiologist when they're doing coronary angiography, okay? So, what are the various types of terumo wires? How can you classify terumo wires? There are many ways of classifying them. So, based on the length, they can be either quick answers, guys. Based on the length, they can either be standard or exchange length. Right? Yeah. So based on the length, they can be either standard or exchange length. Very good. Then based on the tip, they can be classified into straight or curved. Very good. And then finally, based on the diameter of the wire, you have 018 wires, 025, 035. So depending on the thickness of the wire, they can be further classified. So there are multiple ways of classifying them. Okay, so then you want stiff wires. We once again touched upon it. The Amplas family of wires, which is stiff, extra stiff, ultra stiff, super stiff. So these are all some of the wires that are stiff, and they're used to help to advance sheets over them for intervention, like ASD closure or some form of stenting. And they often have a floppy tip, and we talked about this floppy tip and the importance of the floppy tip. On this wire, you can see, actually, when we talked about the wire structure, remember we said it had a core, and then it had on top of that a layer of, a coiled wire layer. This diagram shows you quite clearly that, there are layers over this wire. Also, the tip is rounded. That's the atraumatic tip that is soldered on. There are other stiff wires like the Rosin wire. These are all, some hardware options that are available in the lab that you have to become familiar with when you start doing complex interventions by yourself. Then we move on quickly to balloon angioplasty catheters. So there's a huge variety of balloons that are available. So you have compliant and non-compliant balloons. An example of a compliant balloon is a tie shack balloon. It's generally a low burst pressure balloon. It has a higher risk of rupturing, but it has a lower profile and is less prone to coughing damage. Okay, so the tie shack family of balloons are very good for infants and neonatal intervention. You have the mini tie shack and the tie shack 2. The non-compliant, a good example of a non-compliant balloon is the Atlas balloon. So it has a very high burst pressure. And you know, these balloons have to be inflated carefully. So for they are used in situations where you need quite a lot of radial force. For example, if you have a conduit which you want to dilate and it's quite tough, then a balloon like this might be useful. But the downside of it is that it can cause rupture of the structure because of being quite stiff and non-compliant. So it has to be used cautiously and with backup of a covered stent and a surgeon. Okay. What is the difference between nominal pressure and burst pressure? Okay, this you guys should know. I would like the answer from you guys. So what is the difference between nominal pressure and burst pressure? No answers? Is there anybody out there? Okay. Hold on. Some answer. So it's the nominal pressure. Okay. Pressure at which the prospect fix size is achieved is a nominal pressure. That's right. So the nominal pressure is at which. Okay. Yeah. So the nominal pressure is the pressure at which the balloon is fully expanded. Okay. So it reaches its optimal size or recommended size. So it's a 10 millimeter balloon. At the nominal pressure, it becomes 10 millimeters. And it is recommended that you inflate the balloon. You don't underinflate the balloon. You have to inflate the balloon to its nominal pressure. Only then it reaches the size. Okay. So for example, you're trying to stent. You have to you have to inflate the balloon up to its size so that the stent then sticks on the wall. Or you're trying to balloon dilate and you're trying to achieve a result, then you have to inflate up to the nominal pressure. The burst pressure, on the other hand, is the maximum pressure beyond which there is a risk of rupture of the balloon. Okay, so this is the difference between nominal pressure and burst pressure. So it's important to know the difference, and it's important to achieve the nominal pressure. And for example, for some tough or stiff lesions, like branch PA stenosis or whatever, you may exceed the nominal pressure, but always be under the burst pressure. Okay. With ETO balloons, burst pressure is, this data may not be completely accurately applicable because there is some damage to the balloon on repeated usage, so you have to be more cautious. Okay, so what are the considerations in selecting a balloon for valvoplasty or angioplasty in children? I think this is something that you'll be very familiar with. You do this on a day-to-day basis, right? When you are trying to, do your balloon procedures, there are some basic considerations. What are they? What are the considerations when choosing a balloon for valvoplasty or angioplasty in children? I'm not sure if we're running out of time, but okay. So the size of the balloon is important, and this depends on the annulus of the valve or the narrowest portion of the vessel, depending on what your indication is. And also depends on the anatomic structure. For example, a pulmonary valve, you will overdilate. An aortic valve, you will underdilate. An aortic coarctation, you will expand according to the size of the descending thoracic aorta, the level of the diaphragm. So the size of the balloon is determined by the structure that you're trying to dilate and what you're trying to achieve. So the diameter of the balloon is important. Then what else about the balloon is important? the length is important. Okay, so in a small child, you can't use a 5 or 6 centimeter length balloon. Okay, because it will go through several structures. So depending on the size of the patient and the structure that you're going to dilate, you have to choose the length of the balloon. Sometimes we don't have much choice because of limited availability of stock, and we have to compromise. Generally, 2 centimeter length balloons can be quite short. In a small neonate or infant, it is okay. But in a slightly bigger child, a 2 centimeter balloon might tend to slip. So you may need a slightly longer balloon in order to maintain stable position. But in a lot of small children, a balloon that is 4 centimeters may be too big. So depending on the child, you have to make a choice of the length of the balloon. So we've talked about diameter, length, then we have to talk about the profile of the balloon. Okay, so the profile of the balloon is important to choose a sheath that is appropriate for the balloon. Some balloons like the Thai Shaft Mini are very low profile, that is the material of the balloon is very thin, so it's easy to put it through a smaller sheath. Particularly when arterial access is needed for the balloon, this profile of the balloon is very important. Then of course we have the nominal pressure and the burst pressure of the balloon. What wire it takes is also important. So, for example, a Thai Shaft Mini might take it takes a smaller wire when you compare it with the other valvoplasty balloons. So, it might either require an 014 or an 018 wire, often an 018 wire. Okay, so I think we have gone through all these. Okay, so examples of balloons used in neonates and infants, we've already touched upon the Thai Shaft series. The Mini Thai Shaft and the Thai Shaft 2, these are one of the best balloons for neonates and infants. They're a bit expensive, which is a problem in resource-limited situations, and maybe more prone to damage on repeated usage, but they are by far one of the best balloons for neonatal aortic stenosis or pulmonary stenosis. The Opta is another balloon. It's a peripheral angioplasty balloon, but it has a pretty good range and profile, uses slightly bigger sheets than the Thai Shaft, but I have used the Opta Pro. It's much cheaper than the Thai Shaft, and it's a cost-effective balloon to use. Of course, in neonates and infants, the other balloon that we commonly use is a septostomy balloon. We'll just look at the septostomy balloon in a short while. Older children and adults, you have a huge range of balloons. You have the Maxi LD, you have the Z-Med. Z-Med is the same company as Thai Shaft. Then you have Atlas. Atlas we already talked about. It's a very non-compliant balloon, particularly used for stiff lesions. Then you have a balloon called the Nucleus. Once again, a very tough, stiff balloon. So these are all some of the balloons that you need to be aware of. So it's important that you familiarize yourself, go around your lab and look at what stocks you have. The vascular interventionalists, interventional radiologists, they have a huge range of peripheral balloons as well. And that can be useful to you in certain situations. Okay, so any cath lab that does a serious intervention needs to have ways of getting out of trouble. Okay, so what are the various retrieval devices that you know of? Guys, very good. So snares, yes, one of the commonest retrieval devices we use is a snare. A bioptome is another device that we use for retrieval. There's something called a vascular forceps. So these are some of the common ones. Okay, bioptome, snare, vascular forceps is an example of snare catheters. They come in different sizes, and depending on the structure that you're trying to open the snare in. For example, if you're trying to open the snare in a branch pulmonary artery, you'll use a smaller snare. If you're trying to open the snare in a bigger chamber, like the right atrium, then a bigger snare is fine. The bigger the snare, the more the chances of catching the wire within the snare. But of course, the size of the snare is limited by the size of the structure inside which you're opening it. Okay, so just a picture of the bioptome. I think you guys would have seen it in the lab quite a lot. It's got it's operated from the back end, and it has jaws that can snap. Okay, so that helps you maybe hold on to devices and pull them back and so on. So there's a multitude of catheter shapes. It's impossible to know all of them and to name all of them, but it's important to get familiar with at least some of them. You have straight pigtails, you have angled pigtails, You have multiple angiographic catheters, and it's important to get just familiar with them and to use them, you know, to suit your indication. Okay, so can you identify these catheters? What are these special? These are special catheters. I mean, all of you can see that it's a pigtail, but what's special about this catheter? It's a marker pigtail. A marker pigtail is useful for measurement, so you don't have to do all this calibration and with the catheter and so on. So essentially, between the top ends of these markers is 1 centimeter, or whatever, between the bottom ends. So it's, you have to use the same end, and it's 1 centimeter, that measurement. You can use that to calibrate, you know, any measurements you want to make on your angiograms. Okay, some more catheters to identify. What is this catheter? Some of it may be repetitive. Any ideas? What is this catheter? These are common catheters that we use in the lab, day in and day out. Anybody? A short primary curve, you know, a tip, the tip is very short. What is this catheter? Yeah, this is a JR, absolutely. JR, multipurpose pigtail, perfect, that's it. So, what is the one that is sitting here on the right? It's not a very clear or close-up picture, so I have to apologize for that. But if you look at the, you know, the fact that there is a syringe attached to the end, and I'll give you a clue, there is a balloon at the tip. This is not a Burman, this is actually a Swan-Ganz, yeah. But of course, you know, you need to be able to see the tip of the catheter in order to know whether there's an end hole or side hole, but this is actually a Swan-Ganz catheter that is being displayed, okay? Okay, so, this is just an illustration, a very diagrammatic illustration of a balloon tip catheter. This catheter is a balloon septostomy catheter. It has a typical shape. I unfortunately could not find a better illustration of it. And I do have some, but I couldn't get a picture of the real McCoy. But essentially what it is this is an old-fashioned Miller's type of catheter. Has a mandrel inside. It doesn't have an end hole. It's a balloon tip catheter with a mandrel inside. So the mandrel is used initially to direct the catheter. It straightens the catheter. But once the catheter enters the right atrium, then the mandrel is actually removed so that the catheter comes back to the shape where it has an angle. And that angle allows us to cross the atrial septum. Okay, and this is used for septostomy, which is carried out either under fluoroscopic or echocardiographic guidance. These catheters are the newer over-the-wire balloon septostomy catheters. I think may be used more nowadays because I think the old-fashioned catheters are very hard to come by nowadays. Balloon septostomy altogether has become a rarer procedure now anyway because majority of children are going directly for arterial switch. So what is this catheter? Just a quick spot identification. What is this catheter? It's a blade septostomy catheter. I haven't really had the occasion to use this, but when the atrial septum is very thick and you're not able to, do a septostomy with a balloon, then this catheter is used in those difficult situations. Sorry. So once again, this is just another catheter. It is black in color. Usually these catheters are glide caps. So this is just a Terumo glide cap, the same Terumo glide cap, but with a different shape. And this shape is called the sidewinder. We saw it earlier. And this is what shape is this? This is once again a Terumo glide cap. They come in different shapes. So this is called a headhunter, okay? Similar to a cobra. So these are Judkins and Amplatz catheters. So we go back to the, somebody had confused the sidewinder for the Amplatz earlier. This is the sidewinder. And this is the AMPLAT. So in terms of its shape, it's kind of similar. Sidewinder has a much longer curve. So they are predominantly used in coronary angiography, as you know. And these illustrations I put in just to see how, you know, they sit differently, particularly the JL, for example. It has, people who have used the JL will know that it has a natural tendency to go and just hook the left coronary artery. The RC, you have to rotate to get it to sit in the right coronary artery, the JR. But the JL will sit automatically. And this is how it sits and just points into the left coronary artery. This is the left, AMPLAT's left. And this has a different mechanism. So this sits within the aortic, over the aortic cuff and engages the left coronary artery. I thought it was just a nice illustration of how the catheter actually sits inside the aorta to engage the coronary artery. Okay, so with that, I think we come to the end of this talk. I hope it's been useful.